different products, New Jersey works for the entire world. Steel cables flow from Trenton to every corner of the globe, and have since 1854, when John A. Roebling proved the value of his steel cables by building a railroad bridge over Niagara Falls. That original cable works at Trenton has since grown into one of the nation's great industries. Here, high-speed machines, geared to meet any engineering requirement, turn out cables of every size, from tiny wire strands to the giant cables used in many of the world's longest bridges. The George Washington Bridge, linking New Jersey with New York, is built with cables made in Trenton. Steel goes into Elizabeth-made sewing machines for homes and factories throughout the world. In Jersey City, tons of steel are each day rolled and coated, lithographed in bright colors, and formed and sealed into tin cans for the food packers and others who can their products for homes and workshops everywhere. In Harrison, engineers and skilled technicians use steel to fabricate pumps large enough to irrigate deserts, and in one instance, powerful enough to reverse the flow of the Sacramento River. And in Camden, steel comes off the ways as fighting ships for our Navy. Steel goes into the fabrication of merchant ships built in our shipyards and carrying New Jersey products to every country of the world. One might ask, how did the tiny state of New Jersey develop such industrial muscles? Well, our school children know where to find some of the answers.
In 1791, Alexander Hamilton, our first Secretary of the Treasury, wrote a report to George Washington. He urged the building of American manufacturing centers. Hamilton said the Paterson Falls in New Jersey could furnish the power for such an industrial experiment. Water power became the base of industry along the Passaic River. Later, as steam and electricity freed industry from dependence on water power alone, the original manufacturing centers grew into great industrial cities.
If Hamilton...